3 miles off the coast of Florida, lies the world's only underwater science lab and human habitat. For the next 96 hours, an elite team of researchers and support crew will live under the sea.
Emergency breathing if necessary.
60 feet underwater, they will conduct critical experiments on a living reef.
It's so new and it's so cutting edge that everything that you do is brand new.
Connected live to classrooms around the world.
We are showing a little piece of the ocean to let them know this is our treasure and we need to save it.
This is Project SeaCAMEL. Key Largo, Florida. A team of scientists prepares to mount a unique expedition to the floor of the Atlantic Ocean. Three researchers have been selected to lead the mission. Captain Phil Renault, Dr. Annalise Hagen, and Dr. Mark Patterson. Each is a specialist and will conduct experiments on the reef that cannot be duplicated in a laboratory or aquarium. They'll be taking thousands of students with them via live webcasts to college and university classrooms around the world. Project SeaCAMEL, Classroom Aquarius Marine Education Live, is the first in a series of underwater classroom projects by the Khaled bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation. They've enlisted the Virginia Institute of Marine Science to develop and lead the classes. Submerged for 4 days, the team will live in the Aquarius Undersea Laboratory. Just a few hours at this depth, and their blood will be saturated with as much nitrogen as it can hold, a uniquely dangerous but manageable condition. If they stay at depth, they can work in the water for 6 to 10 hours at a time. Here, they can accomplish in 4 days what would take more than a month diving from a boat. But they cannot shoot to the surface if there's a problem. Nitrogen would cause their blood to bubble, a potentially deadly condition. A safety team monitors their every move, and the global webcast begins.
In 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, take mark.
Today, for the next hour, we're going to tell you what it's like to live and work underwater. Why is there a laboratory off the coast of Florida?
The Aquarius habitat is anchored in the sand next to a coral reef. Reefs serve as protective barriers against the power of the surging ocean to erode coastlines.
When you have hurricanes down here, it can be pretty violent. They had a hurricane a number of years ago that actually shifted this whole structure.
Reefs are also breeding grounds for enormous varieties of fish. 1/4 of all fish in the ocean rely on coral reefs for at least a portion of their lives. Microscopic algae live inside coral, converting sunlight into carbohydrates to fuel these tiny animals. They are as beautiful as they are fragile. Pollution, overfishing, sediment from land development, and water heated by global warming can all stress coral to their breaking point. Stressed corals expel their algae, bleaching, and begin to die. The SeaCAMEL team's first mission, measure the health of this reef.
We're gonna go out to Phil, who I think has been counting some of his transect squares.
Underneath the quadrat, it's mostly algae.
Captain Renault's survey shows only 6 to 8% live coral cover. The world's healthiest reefs have over 50% live coral cover. Worldwide, the picture is bleak. 20% of the planet's coral reefs have been effectively destroyed in the last few decades. Another 25% are on the brink of collapse. Next, Dr. Patterson tests this coral's ability to convert sunlight to energy. A blast of light from a fluorometer causes the algae's chlorophyll to glow. The intensity tells the computer how efficiently it's working.
So this coral is about 68% efficient.
shielded from the sun, its photosynthesis efficiency drops to 58%.
So we've seen a dramatic change in the photosynthetic efficiency just in a matter of a couple of minutes here.
Evidence that corals adapt to changing light conditions. The team signs off.
We hope you're all enjoying these live broadcasts from underwater.
And prepares to enter a strange new world. Night. The reef explodes with color as nocturnal corals awaken from their slumber.
Good evening, everybody. This is Mark Patterson. I'm talking to you from the world's only underwater laboratory, Aquarius. Annalise, let's go prospecting for some interesting fluorescence patterns of some of the marvelous invertebrates out there on Conch Reef.
Tiny shrimp-like animals called zooplankton swarm up from the bottom in search of a meal. They must avoid night predators like this basket star. Corals feed by shooting out venom-filled barbs called nematocysts, paralyzing their prey. Tentacles seize the helpless zooplankton and pull them into the coral's stomach.
This is a beautiful example of a Montastrea cavernosa feeding. All its tentacles are extended. What I'm going to do is very carefully touch just one of the polyps.
When a single coral polyp senses danger, it retracts, sending a warning to the rest of the colony through a primitive nerve net.
And now the entire colony has retracted its polyps.
Corals are renowned for their vivid color.
And some of these have a function. Some of them are actually sunscreens. These chemical compounds are found in corals that live in shallower water to protect them from ultraviolet light, which can damage their DNA.
Here, in the darkness, the scientists use a powerful blue light to instantly reveal the fluorescent colors of juvenile corals, too small to be seen without magnification.
I can see a lot of different species.
At one time, scientists thought only corals and sponges had this fluorescence. Recent discoveries show that the mantis shrimp has fluorescent spots, which it uses to warn other shrimp out of its territory.
So here we are outside the bunk room on the outside of the habitat. This you really can't see during the day. All these tentacles just come alive at night.
Dr. Hagen discovers creatures hiding on the walls of the habitat.
If we zoom in here as well, we can see these little worms, and they're called Christmas tree worms.
The night's final experiment.
We found the plankton net just off the starboard bow of the habitat.
See if the zooplankton have the same fluorescent properties as coral.
Yeah, there's definitely some fluorescence going on in there.
Gotta say goodbye to Annalise and Phil outside here. Thanks, guys. You did a great job tonight. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.
24 hours since the mission began.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Captain Phil Renaud, the Executive Director of the Living Oceans Foundation.
The team turns its attention to some of the most ancient creatures on the planet. Sponges. They appeared about 500 million years ago, one of the first multicellular animals in the ocean.
This sponge right now, at this time of day, is actually producing more oxygen than it's consuming.
Water is pumped through a sponge with miniature whip-like fingers as other hair-like extensions filter out picoplankton, too small to see with the naked eye. Incredibly efficient, sponges harvest 99% of the plankton flowing through them. These giant barrel sponges have been called the redwoods of the sea, living more than 200 years. Others are estimated to live 10,000 years.
And here comes the water pumping out.
The team injects harmless fluorescein dye inside the sponge to make its water flow visible.
It's moving about 4 inches a second.
Sponges may look like easy targets for predators. Their secret to survival lies hidden inside.
I found you a smaller sponge of the same species.
Creatures that bite a sponge encounter powerful poisons. Some simply taste bad. Others cause severe burning and rash-like reactions. Scientists around the world are studying these compounds to see which could be useful in attacking human diseases, like cancer.
Research diver, this is Aquarius, over.
Day 3. The team prepares for its most challenging mission. The surface support ship is carrying a robot called an AUV, autonomous underwater vehicle.
What we want this thing to do today is to use one of its onboard sensors, called the side scan sonar, to actually image the fish life around the habitat.
At nearly 8 feet long and about 250 pounds, Fetch can swim much faster than a human and run for hours.
A robot like this is essentially a taxi cab for sensors.
The robot carries a video camera and high-frequency sonar to map the reef. Other sensors measure water quality, oxygen level, pH, temperature, and salinity. Fetch is equipped with software that builds a memory of items scanned. In time, it can recognize almost everything it sees in the ocean, even identifying fish by species.
The Fetch did a good dive, and it's back on the surface.
The robot's data will be downloaded for study to expand our understanding of how coral reefs function and are damaged by human activity.
What a marvelous week we've had here on Concrete during these 6 broadcasts.
Project SeaCAMEL has been a success, connecting the next generation of marine scientists to advanced research.
I will sign off now. Thank you to all of you for joining us.
The Khaled bin Sultan Living Oceans Foundation is embarking on a multi-year global expedition to survey remote and unexplored reefs. This is Science Without Borders, driven to develop conservation strategies, committed to helping save our priceless reefs.